each away after lunch. So let me see how much my talk is going to be interesting. That's also one indicator for me. Okay, great. Okay, so the main theme of my talk is how a leadership can play its role effectively for enterprise agility. Okay, so there are several factors for enterprise agility success, but my talk is going to be there purely on leadership. When I say what leadership, it has a different level, like team. There are leadership team, there are leadership program, there are leadership portfolios, like they are senior executives. Okay. All these people, how they participate and execute their role, so that enterprise agility can be successful. Okay. So the responsibility for leadership is they have to change the whole system. If they cannot change, no one else can. So they cannot leave everything to the workers. So that's the main theme of my topic. Okay? So people who don't know me, my name is Niranjan. So I am a founder of Excel Plus Services. It's a one-man consulting company. So I have been working as a practicing agile since last 7 years. My main job in this work is to coach, consult, and train on agile, scrum, lean, and things like that. Okay. So what I'm going to talk is based on my experience in coaching, training, and consulting. So the agenda of my discussion will be like that. So initially, I will talk about what are the current challenges that the leadership is facing to achieve the enterprise agility. So then I'll come to what are the different leadership styles one can execute. So what are the different leadership styles people can choose to execute their style of leadership? Okay. Then I'll be talking about how a lean agile leadership. It's not a traditional leadership what I'm going to talk. I'll talk about a lean agile leadership can play its role to achieve the success of enterprise agility. Okay. Then the last part of my talk is a small game on lean thinking. So it's just around 10-15 minutes game. So that's how I have structured my talk. Okay, so all of you know this person. So he's one of the famous quality guru. Deming says, okay, very clearly he says that it is not enough that management commit themselves to quality and productivity, and they should first know what they must do. So it's a very profound statement. So the main, what the thinking behind here is, it very clearly says that it's not always management sets the goal for quality, productivity improvements, but at the same time they should know how they are going to achieve. So if they don't know, then they cannot help the team to achieve it. So they have to teach them. So that is one of the main thing what Deming says. So if you, at the same time, continuing the same discussion, the Peter Drucker, the management guru, he very clearly says that, you know, what he says that today's knowledge workers, you don't have to teach any special thing to the knowledge workers. They already know what they have to do. The management, what best management can do is they have to provide the right environment for them to execute their work. They don't have to teach any special skills to execute their work. Maybe it is true in the other kind of workers, maybe production workers, but in the case of knowledge workers, management role is not to do a lot of micromanagement activities. So they have to build the capability of the team. That is most important. If the management can start developing the people, the people can develop the solutions. The management need not think about focusing on developing the solutions. So that is, Peter Drucker very clearly says that, and that's, we don't see often in many organizations, we see a lot of micromanagement happens from different managers. So they are very much focused on improving the focusing on mundane and trivial tasks what each and every person is doing, but they should focus on something else. If they focus on developing the people, that is more effective than focusing on purely on developing the solution.
Okay.
So for enterprise agility, the foundation is the leadership. So the leadership plays a very important role in achieving the enterprise agility. Okay. So when I talk about leadership, the traditional leadership is not going to be helpful to achieve enterprise agility. So when I say leadership, I talk about lean agile leadership. The first of all, the leadership, when they're trying to implement enterprise agility, first of all, they should take the responsibility of the success of lean agile. If they don't take the responsibility, they cannot expect the success from the teams. So first of all, that is something which normally is not seen in many organizations when they go for enterprise agility, when they think about having agility at enterprise level. So a lot of accountability, a lot of responsibility has to be taken from the management. Like example, the question is, lean agile is the people who have the understanding about lean as well as agile. So, okay, you don't know what is lean. Okay, I think you need to, I'll take it up later. Okay, so because I do not want to slightly move away from the discussion. Okay. So, like example, I'll come to this slide later. So, example, Toyota. So they have a training, 2 to 6 weeks for any employees when the person starts. So the management should focus on something very important. Example, let us say the inventories which are not finished is a major contribution for delays. Like example, when you talk about software development, so a code which may be developed, but if it is not tested, and if it is not tested, it is unfinished inventory. So more and more such codes will always add to the delay in the process. So if people are not taught about these kind of things, then no point in doing the quality of the code, improving the quality of the code, no point in, they can still do all those things, improving the effectiveness of testing. But if they don't understand how to use these kind of lean concepts, so then it's difficult to achieve the success. So the management should focus, first of all, on how much of our peer had training on lean agile. Okay. So coming back to this, it's not just teaching. The next one is, when I talk about lean agile leaders, it's not just implementing, but when I say they also should act as a teachers. I don't call them as a managers. So they should not behave as a lean agile managers, but they should behave as a teachers. So they should teach each and every person who is practicing how to practice, how to use lean, how to use agile, and how to apply the systems thinking kind of approach for the enterprise agility. If they cannot teach, then naturally team members cannot understand. But if they have to teach, first they have to understand what is lean and what is lean agile. So how a lean agile behavior can be possible. If they don't understand, they are not able to teach. That is something which is very important. Like example, if you take a call, no more inventory. So that's something, if a sort of a policy statement, like let's not have a no more inventory. So that means it's very clearly you're setting a goal that, you know, no untested code. So if there is untested code, don't even give it for sprint reviews. So first try to finish. It's not starting important, but how do you finish is important. So that's very, very important. So also, what are the different delays? So where we can identify the delays in the process, all these delays will contribute to the total cycle time. So the touch time will be very, very less, but the non-validated time will contribute to the delays. So the leadership should focus more on teaching these kind of lean agile behavior for the teams which practicing the who are working in enterprise engineer.
Okay. So
the bottom line,
what I'm trying to say is,
the management should develop people.
So management should
the emphasis here is they should focus more on developing the people. And if they develop people, then the people will develop the solutions. They don't have to worry about how to deliver the solutions. So that give the job to the team, they will take care of. So management should focus more and more whether we are building, whether we are developing the capability of the people. So that is the main focus when I talk about lean agile leaders' behavior. Okay? So Dean Leffingwell is one of the father of scaled agile framework. He says very clearly, the lean agile leaders have to be lifelong learners. So unless we are lifelong learners, we will not be able to achieve the success. So a lifelong learners of how to implement lean, how to implement agile, and how to have a systems thinking approach. So with all these things only, we can build better systems. So better systems can be built with constant improvement in our knowledge and experience. So they have to be lifelong learners. It's not that few days of training or few days of work that will make them to finish the work, make them to get satisfied. So they have to be continuously lifelong learners in order for enterprise agility. So what are the different leadership styles so that a leader can exhibit? So there are three different leadership styles which David Bradford talks about. So a leader can choose to be an expert. So leader can behave as an expert. So leader can also behave as a conductor. And third leadership style is leader can behave as a developer of a people. Okay? So let's try to quickly understand what it means. Okay. In this kind of leadership style, the leader behaves as an expert. So this leadership style is very, very suitable where the leader is supposed to have an expertise in his job. So if he doesn't have an expertise, people will not come to him. So he need to have in-depth understanding about the job, and people will always look for him for the solution. So he is looked at a problem solver. So he cannot live for solving the problem for this reportees, because he is supposed to be an expert. So this kind of leadership style will not be suitable in all places. This kind of leadership style is only suitable in where the technical expertise. The expertise is going to be very, very important. So these guys, they suit very nice for technology-oriented role. So one has to choose the leadership style according to the place, what kind of style is required. So next one is a leadership style which I am talking is on leader can behave as a conductor. So this is the most common style. So here, the leader acts as a central coordinator. So this person is a central coordinator, and he coordinates with multiple departments, multiple stakeholders, okay, multiple teams, whatever. Okay. So when this kind of leadership style is very, very effective. So this kind of leadership is effective when organization peak performance depends on the coordination. Without coordination, the peak performance cannot happen. So in such places, this leadership style will be very, very effective. So people can choose appropriately according to the situation. The third leadership style is a leader who behaves as a developer of people. And this is a leadership style which I'm going to stress more for agile leaders. If leaders have to implement agile or lean, so their style of leadership should be more on behaving as a developer of a people. They should focus more on developing the people. Okay? So how leadership can play its role effectively for enterprise agility? So the next portion of my talk is, what are certain areas lean agile leadership can focus for success of enterprise agility? It's a quite huge topic. So, but I'm just going to touch upon very, very high level. What are some areas where a leadership can focus? Okay. One is a system thinking approach. So, whatever when the leaders
when we talk about enterprise agility, they should not look at focusing on the parts. Okay, they need to always have a systems thinking approach. So the systems thinking approach is focusing on a whole as a system. Okay. So in fact, the Deming very clearly says, it is the system, not the workers, that ultimately determine quality and productivity. So according to Deming, the data, he says that in fact 94% of mistakes is caused because of poor systems. Only 6% of the mistakes is caused because of workers. So you can imagine where the focus should be. And the system, unless the systems are changed, it cannot we cannot expect the success. No point in focusing on the performance of the team when the problem is elsewhere. Okay? And that has to be done by the management. So only management can change the system, no one else. Okay? So that's very very powerful and very truthful statement. Okay? So for that, so need to have a systems thinking approach. So when I say systems thinking approach, one of the ways is the one should understand the complete value stream. So means the where the work starts, where the work ends. The right where the software is conceptualized till the software is deployed, what all the activities involved right from beginning to the end, where all the activities the people should have clearly the visibility and identify which of those activities contribute for the delays. It's not just focusing only on the coding part, so we do better coding, which will help us to increase, accelerate the delivery. We have to look at the entire value stream. So that the responsibility is for the leadership to teach to the team. So if leadership cannot teach that to the team, we can't expect the team to follow it. Okay? So by removing the delays in the non-valued activities, we can improve the cycle time. So that's the whole value stream analysis helps to reduce the delays so that the cycle time can be improved. Okay? So when the lean agile leadership is having a systems of thinking approach, it's not just focusing on the part, it's the whole system with the people who are within the system, how they interact, the subsystems, how they behave. So unless the interaction between the subsystems are effective, there cannot be a system performance. We can't expect a peak performance at system level. So if we have to achieve this, think about the system performance, the people who are working in different silos or different groups have to interact well. Then only the value can be demonstrated, then only the value can flow across the all these people. The value cannot just happen in one single place. It has to flow from start till the end, and that can happen provided there is an effective interaction. Then only the performance of the system gets increased. Okay. So next area which the lean agile leadership should focus is on how to embrace the agile manifesto. That's very important. See, when I say agile manifesto, it's not simply doing agile, so it's more of being agile. When I say being agile, it is more of culture, mindset. So the management should focus more and more on changing the mindset and building the culture. So it takes time. A lot of patience is required. So doing agile is completely different from being agile. So being agile is more on culture, mindset. Doing agile is more on practices. Just by practicing agile, we can't be always being agile. So we have to demonstrate. So for that, we have to demonstrate, if the team has to demonstrate the values of principle, first management should understand and support. Okay. And if there is not right support from the leadership at a different level, we can't achieve the enterprise agility. Okay? So it's not, there could be many frameworks like Scrum, XP, okay, we have SAVE, we have BLESS. So it's not simply applying all these frameworks blindly. So one should know how to implement them. So when we think, when I say when how to implement, it's very, very lot of things in it. But the bottom line is, we have, the management should question whether there is a continuous stream of value, whether the people are delivering the value continuously. That's very, very important. It's not, you know, delivering value once, okay, then afterwards there is a breakage in the value. There has to be continuous value. What is the advantage? If there is a continuous value, then only the customers can have trust in those kind of things. If the if we have to build the trust in the customers, then the value should be always delivered continuously. So that can happen only if we have a very good, strong understanding how to implement all. It's not just understanding these frameworks, but we should lead agile leadership. The leadership should know how to implement these kind of things. Okay. So in this process, the team management should focus more and more building on cross-functional team. So the value cannot happen in vertical functions. So it's more like working as a component teams. So the feature teams are the best hallmark of cross-functional teams. So the leadership focus should be more on building the feature teams where the value cannot follow in silos. So if the value has to happen, the whole, all these members should work as a team. So the today the management challenge is how to connect these silos. So that is where the management should spend more time in connecting the silos so that they behave as a cross-functional team. Okay. The next, another area which is very important is traditional product development is different. But when I talk about enterprise agility, I talk about lean product development. So what are the principles to design a system based on lean product development is something which the leadership should have an understanding. Like example, when I am discussing that, so the one nice metaphor that comes to my mind is, you all of us see the freeways. So suddenly in the freeways, vehicles will be moving. After some time, they'll come to stop. So how it comes to stop? So maybe the person, so let us say all these vehicles are moving at 60 miles per hour. Okay, the guy, the first guy, then suddenly reduces speed to 50 miles per hour. So this guy reduces 50 miles speed, then the car just follows behind. So he has to maintain some distance, he will reduce his speed. So, or he will swerve. So, like this, as it's happening, more and more cars, vehicles start reducing their speed, then ultimately it reaches a stage where the whole vehicle traffic crawls and it comes to stop. So this, the traffic plans, they call it as shockwave. So the person who created a shockwave, you would have already got. But these are the people who suffer. Okay. So these are the people who are very, very important, who create in the beginning. Okay. So that is something which we have to think about when we talk about product development. So at the same time, so another thing is, it's also a funnel effect. So what is the funnel effect? So example, the funnel effect, if you put right quantity of water, the right amount of water will flow. But if you put too much amount of water in the beginning, instead of flowing through, it comes back. So the initial people who work, they are very important. The initial guys, these guys who are in the traffic, they are very important. If they start creating the shockwave, then the whole traffic will be under big problem. So this is what happens in our product development. The batch size and the queue items, let's say product backlogs or program backlogs or portfolio level, we maintain some backlogs. The initial items, the queue length have to manage such that, you know, the queue length is not too high, so that the wait time becomes very, very long. Okay. So they did a study somewhere in May 2001. So to study the highway throughput. Okay. So in the first situation, the vehicle was moving at 30% of the capacity, and the speed was 65 miles per hour. So when this was done, the throughput is 400 vehicles per hour could move. Okay. Second, they increase the capacity and the speed is 65, not 45, and the throughput increased. Okay. So that should have become true when you increase the capacity. So what happened when they increase the capacity? 95%. In fact, the throughput should have increased, but it did not. It got decreased. Okay. So more and more, the less vehicles will start moving per unit hour. So this is what happens in our product development. So if we handle too many things at a time, then the whole, instead of finishing things, the throughput gets impacted. So the batch size has to be optimal. So that is something the people should think about when we think about enterprise agility. So we should know always where to identify the bottleneck. The bottlenecks are the ones which always impact the throughput. So if we don't identify the where is the bottleneck, we cannot increase the throughput. So that can happen provided we have the visibility of the work. So we should know how to visualize the work by exposing our WAPs, exposing our items which are doing, what are the items that are ongoing. So that is something the organization should think of. Okay? So the optimum batch size is very important. Instead of, let's say, a project requires 100 members, instead of putting all 100 members in one place, break them into small batches. So reduce the batch size. So when you reduce the batch size, it goes through the system faster. The faster the system, the throughput will be more. The wait time will be reduced. So if you have bigger batches, the wait time will be more. So we can control the wait time only through by controlling the queue length. Okay. So finally, the area is which I'm going to talk is apart from what has spoken, the leadership also should create the right environment for the people to succeed. Okay, so there should be a team, the environment where people mutually influence each other. Okay, so to explain that, so then whatever is explained is taken from a book called Drive. The book title is The Surprising Truth to What Motivates Us. This is the title of the book. In 1949, Professor Harry Harlow did an experiment on rhesus monkeys. Rhesus is one type of monkeys. So he put them in cage and he carried the 2 weeks experiment. So the puzzle was the three steps. Pull out the vertical pin, undo the hook, lift the hinge cup. This is just three steps they had to follow. So what was the result is, when the puzzle was given and the monkeys were put in the cage, there are no external motivators, there are no rewards, things like that. When this was happening, the monkeys started solving the puzzles quite frequently. And as the time passed, they started taking less time to solve the puzzles. And there was no external motivation, no rewards, things like that. Like normally we give salary hikes, rewards for persons improvement of productivity. But here no such external motivation. So this was a bit interesting and peculiar for him. So then he added a raisins to see that how most monkeys will solve the puzzle. In fact, when the raisins were added, the monkeys committed more mistakes. Okay, they solved the problems less frequently. So what it means is, it's not the rewards that is going to motivate the people. A person should have some intrinsic drive. So a person should have some internal drive to execute the work. So how a performance of an employee or a worker can be increased is the three factors. Okay, which talks about, the same book talks about what motivates us. Autonomy, mastery and purpose. So autonomy, the right environment and person to have free environment to decide. Like example, Google. Google has a policy of 20% of time people work on side projects. So because people have this flexibility, they do quite a lot of good things. In fact, 50% of offerings in a year for Google comes from people who spend whatever work they have done, they contribute 20% of the time. Gmail was created by one of the guys who took it as a project in the 20% of time. And in fact, another guy was very much bored about having an online news. Then he created a Google News. So this is when one of the great examples when the autonomy is there, how an organization can achieve. Next one is mastery. Mastery means unless person is engaged, we cannot expect a mastery. If person is anxious, if person behind boredom, we can't expect mastery from him. What is mastery? Doing better thing, becoming better and better day by day. So they did a study in US. Okay, Cornell University did a study. So what they did is they studied how many people are engaged, disengaged in US. They found 50% of people are disengaged in US. Out of 50%, 20% are actively disengaged. And this, the cost of this was $300 billion to the US government. This, you can imagine, this is the more than the GDP of countries like Israel, Portugal, Singapore. So this is what happens when the employees are disengaged. So that should be...
We're out of time.
Yeah. Yeah. And just last slide. Okay. So the last factor which contributes is purpose. So here, when I talk about purpose, it's not profit motive. Organization should, of course, people should be there to make profit. But apart from that, how much purpose motive the organization have, that is very important. So just to make you understand, I'll just give an example of a company called Town Shoes. This Town Shoes is a shoemaking company in US. What they have policy is every pair of shoes what is made. When it is made, each pair of that shoes in that fellow who makes is in his name, that shoes is donated to poor countries, South African countries. So like every pair, when the person makes, one pair is donated in his name. So then people start getting surprised whether this Town Shoes is there for charity or they make business. Okay, whether they are using business model for doing charity or they want money to do the charity. So they were like, they're confused. Then the Town Shoes put very nicely on the website, we are a profit making company but having the intention of giving. This is what they said. So every organization's profit motive is okay, fine, but people would like to work in organizations where they have more larger purpose. So there's a video on a 10 minutes video in YouTube you can watch. Okay. So that's it about my talk. Okay. So these are some references. I will share my slide. Okay. So thank you very much. So can I take 10 minutes for a game?
Would we take 10 minutes for a game?
Yeah.
Is it possible to do that after there's an open out session that we have?
Okay.
Approximately at...
But I think this will... We are in the thought process. So this just take 10 minutes and that will be the complete satisfaction.
What do we do? Actually, I would also have to ask the other speaker that is scheduled that slot.
Yeah, so I just, only with the other's permission.
So I don't want to take the call myself.
Deepak,
we do?
Okay, how many of us here wants to do Game by Niranjan at the open house session at 4 o'clock or 4:30? Raise your hands. Okay, how many of us want to do the game now? And I will leave it to you, sir. What do you want to do?
Okay, I think most of the majority feels that to have it in open session.
Open session? Okay, let's do that in open session.
Okay. So the game is about lean thinking. So the
game is about lean thinking. So just to tell you, by reducing the batch of the system, how it faster it goes through the system. It's a very penny game. Some of you might be already knowing it. So let's try to do it in the open session. Okay. So if you have any questions,
is it okay to take some one or two questions?
Absolutely.
Yeah, go ahead.
This is
not an assault on all the managers we have or we will be having. But if you take cross section of organizations in Bangalore, the top 10 of leadership you have is from an era where there was no agile. How do we train these leaders who have never heard of agile to think about agile and you know apply to people who are living in agile?
Okay, so yeah, that is so the question is that when we talk about organizations, many organizations are still traditional, so they don't even know the agile. Okay, and how do we talk, think about making them to apply agile? Is it is that is your question?
No, that's a larger question.
Okay.
The question is that you know, every leadership of all the organizations in Bangalore take that. They have grown up in an environment where they have never heard about agile. Now if you are asking them to follow agile or be an agile leader, that's a lot of task for them. So in 40 years, 50 years, they worked on...
Absolutely. That is where when I talk about agility, I'm not just telling about agile. It's the three things I talk about. One is, they should know lean. Okay? They should know agile. They should know systems thinking. These three and lean product development, it's not traditional product development. All these things, when they apply all this knowledge combined only, we can think of having enterprise agility. But only knowing agile, maybe we can achieve it at a team level. But achieving agility at enterprise level, only knowing agile will not be useful. Okay, so they have to apply all these things in a combined manner. Then only they can.
Okay. Okay, any other questions for Niranjan? Okay. I see that space empty. If you have questions for him, please stick them up here. Niranjan?
Thank you very much. It was a pleasure having you.